Would you all please stand to do the pledge to the flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we are going to start the meeting with recognition of some of our guests. The first person that we would like to recognize is for the holiday card artist, Lily Hug. Bill, are you going to do the presentation? And Lily, if you would come up, that would be awesome.
So it is a real pleasure for me to introduce to you Lily Hug. Lily is a ninth grade student at Hounds High School. And you will see her artwork here depicted on the screen, but her artwork was selected as the 2021 Holiday Artwork Selection. And so we had over 200 submissions from students in elementary, middle, and high school, and a rigorous committee met and examined all of the entries, and Lily's clearly stood apart from the rest. And so we invited her and she and her family to be here this evening, and we would love to have her talk to you about the conception behind her design. And she's a former recipient of this honor from her time as an elementary level student. So this is one of our first, if not only, multi-year.
Look at that.
Oh, nice.
That's awesome.
Hello. Hello.
Well, you can see that my one from this year is much better than I got lucky the first time. But this time I actually put thought into it. So all of the snowmen represent the different schools. The small one in the back is Moyer, the two in the front are Johnson and Woodville. Big one in the back is the middle school. And then the big one in the front is the high school. So it was all of them just hanging out.
Do you remember what year it was that you won with the other one?
When I was in first grade. So
8 years.
A long time.
So have you been doing one each year?
Well, no. These are only 2 times I've entered.
Well, you're
wow.
Go by a lot.
Yeah, that's good. That's awesome.
Well, thanks for giving other people a chance.
So there were some really outstanding entries this year. We had them at the holiday walk, kind of all spread out. This one in particular was really great that it caught the eye of a lot of the judges, because and it's hard to see up on the screen right now, but you can the letters for the schools are in there. You see the mascots within the hat. And there's a lot of action and representing the whole district. So nice work.
Thank you.
Congrats.
Great job.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, along with this is a shirt and then a check for, it's $50, isn't it? $50. So you're a professional.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you, Lily.
All right. The next section is Bill again, talking about the Cognia Schools of Distinction Award.
Yes, so for Star Recognition this month, we wanted to bring to your attention and to the attention of the public a recent award that we have that has been bestowed amongst us or upon us. And it is the Cognia School of Distinction Award. You will recall that in June of 2021, we did a report on our reaccreditation process in Cognia. And as a result of that reaccreditation, we received commendations for a variety of the work that we were doing, as well as opportunities for growth and improvements. Based upon the level of success that we were able to demonstrate through the rigorous rubrics that Cognia uses to evaluate our systems, we were actually chosen for an international honor that is referred to as Schools of Distinction. So specifically, you will see that it's a recognition that schools and districts have the capacity to earn from around the world. essentially are examining the performance of the schools and districts of whom they evaluate and determining, and then they determine who stands apart from the rest in what capacity. So specifically, we found out as a school district in mid-November that we were selected for this honor. We went through a system accreditation. So Cognia evaluates schools based on individual school performance or on system level performance. And system would refer to the school district as a whole. So our reaccreditation was a compilation of all of our schools' efforts together for the completion of that reaccreditation process. We, as you all know, because you were valued stakeholders in that process, there was internal preparation and then an external outside review team that utilized a series of evidence and data to determine how did we stand up against the performance standards that are embedded within there, but within the accreditation process. And so a school of distinction stands apart from the rest of the schools and systems of whom they evaluate based on the high quality instruction that they see, the consistent organizational effectiveness, and then the maintenance to a commitment to continuously improve. And what I wanted to capture for you was specifically, you know, four concepts. First of all, this is an international honor, which I know is very important to the board. It's very important to Superintendent Robinson that we continue to strive for not just the highest accolades, but the highest levels of opportunity for our students that open up more doors for them for the future. I reported for, on behalf of the district back in June, our IEQ score, which is the Index of Education Quality. That is the score that schools and or districts earn, systems earn, based upon those performance rubrics that Cognia uses for the evaluation process or accreditation process. I reported to you that we had a fairly astronomical score back in 2021, or in this year, of 387.42. That's as compared to the IEQ score that the district earned during its accreditation process in 2015, which was 308.29. I would identify that high IEQ score is certainly probably a significant factor in the determination that we were a school of distinction. I also wanted to point out that the average range for institutions when they go through this process in earning IEQ scores is somewhere between 278.34 and 283.33. So I have a reference to that so that you can see how significantly above that range our school district earned through that reaccreditation. And it's also important to note that that IEQ range is on a scale of 100 to 400. So we were quite close to the most upper echelon of that possible score recording. With regards to Cognia schools of distinction, in Kentucky, there were 5 total institutions recognized. They ranged from private after-school programs, public high school as a singular entity, a private high school as a singular entity, and a non-school traditional magnet program. We were the only public school district in Kentucky that earned this accolade. And so you should be proud, the district should be proud. Certainly us at the school level and at the district level are very proud, and so we wanted to take advantage of this opportunity to make note of that and to celebrate this particular recognition.
Awesome.
Having been through these as a counselor, it was called, it's just a third name.
For a variety of
names.
Structural,
yeah. Yeah. It's a big deal at the high school because when our kids apply to schools and go, you know, the schools around here know us, but, you know, they apply to Stanford, let's say. It's the first line of, I got an application, I got a transcript, and it says something about what sets our school apart. We're not just some school in Kentucky. And so I feel that it's really important that we do self-studies and we go through this, and it is part, it'll be right on the profile of Highlands High School. It goes with every transcript out there. So there's an implied thing that it says, plus they can go to that area, you know, to that website and find out more about Highlands High School. So I think it really benefits our children as they want to apply to all kinds of high-flying schools. So I know that it was a lot of work, having been on, at that time it was, you know, low tech, so we would do binders of things. So, but I probably the technological equal of binders of information that they were looking for. So thank you for doing that.
To everyone.
Our original accreditation, I believe, went back to 1914.
Yeah.
It was the first year we were accredited by the Southern Association for Schools. And as Ann talked about, and they talked about, there have been variations of names. One of the goals that we've had is to be a destination district, both for families that want to move here and teachers that want to relocate to teach here. And the accreditation process is one where you can have peer reviews to look at systems in place that consider test scores, but also systems within your schools. So it's quite an honor. The accreditation process does require us to be in a continuous improvement cycle. But I wanna finish with Bill in particular led a lot of these efforts over the last year in some very non-traditional environments. And so kudos to you and the leadership that you provided here along with the team. So we thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bill.
Thank you. Thanks. All right, the next is a student showcase from the middle school, Birds Leadership, and it's Scott Perrin. If he would come up here and bring your children, your middle school people. Okay.
Hey, I just wanted to say a few words to the board.
Good.
We've got a variety of leadership opportunities at HMS. Primarily student council, which is open to everyone. However, Mr. Perrin really piloted this new leadership opportunity for our students, and they've rolled with it and expanded it to sixth grade and eighth grade from the seventh grade. So I'll let him take it from here, but we are really proud of these guys, and let me show you what they got.
Scott Perrin. I was thinking, I was sitting in my orientation, new teacher orientation here at Fort Thomas 2 years ago, and Bill Bradford kept talking about Leader in Me, and I kept listening to it, thinking, what's a way that I can get students, one, more leadership, and two, get their voices heard? One of the biggest things I've heard at schools is students always feel like their voice isn't heard, or they don't get to contribute the way that they can. And, I wanted to give them a chance to be able to get their voice heard, get their amazing ideas out there, because they have so many amazing ideas just from talking to this group of students almost all the time. So I sat down and kind of thought of what are some things that we want from our students. So we have effective leaders, showing the bluebird pride all the time, great communicators, creative problem solvers. They also had to get their parents' permission before they could do this, because it does take a lot. They had to make a speech video. We were going to make it kind of like an election. They were elected by their peers and by their staff at Highlands Middle School. And then they also had campaign posters, which these are some examples of their campaign posters. They did an amazing job with their posters all up around the school. They also made videos, which we're going to watch one of them.
Carly Skirvin, and I'm running to become one of the sixth grade representatives for Team 2. I would love to bring new and creative ideas into HMS. Let's see some of the ideas I have. My first idea I have is to start new clubs. One of the clubs I want to start is Unified Club. It will give an opportunity for some of our friends with disabilities a chance to play a sport. My second idea I have is pep rallies for HMS games. My third idea I have is holiday parties. My fourth idea I have is school spirit days, including Blue Day, Pajama Day, etc. My final idea is to have Sharpen the Saw a couple times a year. Sharpen the Saw is one of the seven habits, and it means to enjoy you. Now that you have seen some of the things I want to accomplish, let's see some of the things that I have accomplished. My first accomplishment was Lemonade for Love. We raised money for Redwood School. In fact, we raised over $1,300. My second accomplishment was being awarded the Kristen McAuliffe Award at Woodfill Elementary. My third accomplishment was being named captain of my volleyball team. Finally, I was a part of West Unified Bocce Ball. I partnered with a student with disabilities to play bocce. This experience was rewarding and fun. If you like some of the ideas I have, I hope you will vote me for student representative.
My name is Addie.
Hi, I'm Carly.
So, some roles that they have taken on is they do attend our team meetings at school. So we give them an agenda that we're about to talk about, and they, you know, present a PowerPoint that they've created themselves on, you know, what they want their voice to be heard as. They also update the hallway bulletin boards. They help out at school events. We've done reward days, and they're the ones leading it. They're the ones in charge. They're the ones running around helping, making sure everything's going smoothly. They also pick the students of the month. They get a choice in who gets picked, because they're the ones that see all the little things that everybody does. They also get their voice heard at the team meeting. So we leave time at the end for them to speak their own mind. And that bocce ball thing that was brought up in the video was also brought up in the team meetings that they wanted to get that started. They, you know, they have to respect each other. They're really good at communicating. They sit in leader meetings. They also are the principal's advisory council. I'm going to let them talk about what they are working on currently.
Hi, I'm Carly Skirvin, and I am talking today about recycling in our cafeteria. In our cafeteria, we do not do very good at recycling. We have been told from many people that there's not good recycling in our cafeteria. So our student representatives wanted to put together a recycling can and some signs to show what we should recycle. So far, it has been a success.
So, for the recycling, there was no recycling at the beginning of this year, and so I thought that was wrong for our cafeteria. So I made a presentation for Ms. and I showed Mrs. Wolfenheim, and we got recycling bins in the cafeteria, and we also got some signs which say like what you can put in them. And it has been a big success, and we've saved a lot of
Hello, my name is Gus Back, and I will be talking about school spirit and also known as making school feel like home. The first picture we have here is on the seventh grade floor, they put up some paper snowflakes and some ribbons that you can kind of see in the back. And this is one way we've been getting into the Christmas spirit. And on other holidays, we'll have those things hanging on the ceilings and on lockers sometimes. The next is the student of the month, which you heard a little bit about in the last presentation. And this is where our student reps choose students that portray the school really well and are good role models. And they usually get a prize like a big cookie or just any little prize. Our next picture is lockers and how we want to decorate them. This is on the sixth grade floor, and we made backpacks to show what we like and what are our hobbies. And on the first locker right here, this person likes to color pink, as you can see. This is a better picture of the seventh grade floor, and it just shows a better view of what they've been doing. And you can also kind of see on their lockers, they have ugly sweaters, which is like the backpacks on the sixth grade floor. They're just an ugly sweater.
trophy case that's only mostly seen by eighth graders because that's the eighth grade floor. So we were thinking of maybe moving it or scattering around the building so more students can be proud of what they've done. And also on the eighth grade floor, it's very bland, as you can see. There's not as much stuff compared to the sixth and seventh grade floors. And if we can get things more decorated, maybe the students can be more proud of what they've done and all their achievements.
Hi, I'm Libby Raker, and we had an idea to do a code drive benefit, but not just for the veterans, but also for other people that need it. We know that there are, like, in the Wiesel parking lot of the preschool, there are, like, drop-off bins partnered with, we think it's Cincinnati Children's, and if we have those coats and we drop them off in that bin, then they will come and get it and provide coats and that for people who need it.
So you can see from all the examples that they've just given, these are the great ideas that they've created, and that's why we started this program. Awesome. Thank you guys for your time.
Thank you. Thank you. We have questions. Okay, so anybody have a question?
So that looked like a website. Is that where students at the middle school can go choose to participate in the service projects? They have access to that?
Yes, everyone has access to HMS Live Learn.
LeadLearn.
Got it. Very cool.
I really like the input, student input for Student of the Month, because it makes me, you know, think sometimes teachers may choose a student and they're not always seeing all sides of that student, and their peers may see some things that they don't. So I think that's super cool that you guys have a voice in that selection.
Does it feel like a different place this year? Do you feel like you're more involved in getting to see things through?
Yes.
Yeah. Very cool. I think a lot of times as teachers, we check in and we say, we have 177 days, now run, you know? So getting a chance to talk, because we see things differently than you all do. So it's very cool. I think I would have noticed that the eighth grade floor was bland, but, you know, you bring it to our attention, you know, which is awesome.
Looks
so,
pretty bland in
thank
that
you.
Picture.
I know, it did.
So. Is this on the first floor, and maybe it's seen by the public, or
I don't
no
know.
One knows why it's brilliant?
Yeah, I don't know, but I think that's cool. I think you've got some great ideas.
You turned it off on me. I like the idea of this leadership in the middle school. Laviv, what you are learning now is going to serve you your whole life, your leadership, and if you choose to go to high school, college, also in civic duty as adults in your own community. And this is where it all starts. And we board members are big on this, and we like to cultivate leaders. So thank you for stepping up and being our future leaders.
For sure.
Thank you.
Great. So, a couple things. I probably would not have noticed the eighth grade bland hallway.
That's because you're running.
Yeah. And so one thing that that has always been on my mind is that the best things in schools happen as a result of students and teachers being engaged in future improvement. I said at our superintendent student advisory the other day that our phrase "rich in tradition, focused on the future." Was a phrase that was created and shared and put forward by a student as part of one of our committees, and it's something that we believe in, and you guys are embodying it. So, Mr. Farron, thank you for taking this on, and thank you all for your leadership roles. It's going to serve you very well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We have T-shirts for all of them, so if we'll give those to you, Mr. Farron, and you can hand those out. That would be great.
How did you all like running for elections? Yeah.
Was it
competitive? Do you have a lot of other
people?
Very competitive. Wow.
That's awesome.
Well, Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Okay. Through with the opening of the meeting, let me go through. The next section will be community forum. Let me read a couple things. Thank you for coming. Let me get the people kind of get settled. Thank you. We are at the community forum portion of the meeting for the Board of Education, and this is an opportunity for members of the community to informally address the board about a variety of topics, including issues for future consideration. Since the topics raised may not be issues listed and advertised on the public agenda, the community forum is not intended to be a setting for dialogue with the board. Direct questions may be referred to the appropriate district personnel for future response, answered briefly if a matter of procedure, or tabled as they may be future agenda items. Sometimes you may even be saying things that are on our agenda that are going to come up later as well. Speakers who have registered at the reception area are asked to identify themselves and state their reason for addressing the board. Please address the Board of Education as a whole through the chairperson rather than individual members. And I want to talk, too, about we ask for any questions or comments that you have. If they're pertaining to an individual, a student, an employee, or a community member, cannot be discussed in an open meeting. Much like we wouldn't want someone to talk about your child or you in an open meeting, we ask for you to go by those wishes as well. It's uncomfortable and it's not right in an open meeting. So we ask you to refrain from talking about personnel or children, okay? All right, the first section, we have, I don't know, maybe four or five people that are wanting to talk about masking and kind of COVID protocols and all that. So we'll start with that first. Do you want to talk about before?
Yeah, just very quickly regarding the masking and COVID protocols, we do have an agenda item in our discussion agenda tonight that's going to address some of the changes that were described in both my letter and video that we put out a couple weeks ago for the changes that will occur when we return from school after the break. Basically, the theme from the start has been that we have tried to take measures that would maximize the number of students that were at school, followed very closely by making sure that we can provide the closest student opportunity to have a normalized school experience as possible. And so Ms. Flaherty will talk about those protocols. So throughout the community forum for the four or five questions or comments regarding that, it's very possible that I may say, we're gonna address that as part of our public commentary when we get to that point. So I'm sorry, when we get to the discussion piece.
Okay. All right, the first person, and I'm sorry if I say your names incorrectly. Lana, is it Jarasset? Lana, thank you. Thank you. Hi.
So, I spent some sleepless nights after listening to some things from last month's board meeting, but in the fun spirit of the season, and since I continue to say that in advocating for the safety of our children and community, I have truly found my once silent voice, and for those from Johnson who know, I'm a little wacky. I thought we'd start with a jingle to lighten the mood before I drone on with some possibly boring online facts. So, we've got Children's Christ Hospital, UC and St. Denis, CDC and FDA and American Academy of Peds, and those working closest with our board, the most valuable health partner of all, Northern Kentucky Health Department. What purpose do you serve? All right, that's all. So I did some follow-up after last month's meeting, and I actually reached out to speak with the director of population health at the health department. So I'm going to provide some information that she sent. A lot of it's linked on their website. For those of you that may or may not know, they actually serve four counties, Boone, Kenton, Campbell, and Grant. They're required to be accredited by the National Public Health Accreditation Board. They are a public agency charged with performing mandated public health services, addressing priority community health needs. They prevent disease, promote wellness, and protect against health threats. Like most public health
planners, data specialists, and administrative support. Their professional staff works with members of the public and with other professionals. Their actions and guidance of the health, the actions and guidance of the health department stem from and are rooted in high quality research and data. Their core values are listed as respect, excellence, adaptability, linkage, and integrity. They put definitions of each of those. The three that I thought were most pertinent to us were adaptability. They list that they creatively apply technology, information, research, and resources to effectively respond to the changing environment and changing needs of those we serve. Linkage, we form and maintain internal and external relationships for the mutual benefit of the community through collaboration and sharing of information, resources, and ideas to achieve a common goal. And integrity, we act with a consistency of character and are forthright, open, and accountable to our customers, our taxpayers, and to each other for our actions. And as a side note, our mayor, Eric Haas, is actually on the District Board of Health, and they set the policy for the Northern Kentucky Health District. The Board of Health does take its direction and aligns almost exactly with the Kentucky State Board of Health, is the communication I received. They are not a partisan group giving guidance on a subject that they're unfamiliar with. While I don't personally know them, I don't have any connection or affiliation with the group, I do think that most of us would agree that those who bear the brunt of working in local public health at the current time aren't doing it for the glamour or the great salary. Their guidance is rooted in facts, scientific evidence, and in protecting public health. So while it doesn't seem the district is legally required to follow their guidance, one would hope that we choose to, as they would be the most appropriate guide for any educated public health decisions and directions we take. So here's what I would like to know and understand. With the changes to the universal masking starting in January, is the district, first of all, keeping the test to stay policy? And again, I understand you can't answer all these questions now. I'm throwing them out to you. The health department guidelines are clear that recommended eligibility for the test to stay program and the modified quarantine requirements are heavily based on universal masking being implemented and expected at the school. Also, the communication received about the January update states that the school health officials were consulted for the changes. Could you please clarify who that includes, if those officials had any concerns or reluctance to adjust now as opposed to waiting until we at least see vaccination rates increase? I know in speaking with the Board of Health, that definitely was not their recommendation. I don't know what discussions were had with them or just it was local school nurses or who it was. I did request some data from the health department, and as of this morning, they can confirm that only 13% of students 5 to 11 years old, so our elementary school age children, in the 41075 zip have received at least one shot of the COVID vaccine. Let's assume that all those 13% of students continue to get the second shot for full vaccination. Be even more bullish, let's say that 1 month into the approval for that age range, many families have been waiting, that they still move forward with their children and get them vaccinated in the next week. And that number doubles by the time we go back to school in January. I think we can agree that's probably a pie in the sky hope, but even if it pans out, that gives us about 26% of our elementary students at least partially vaccinated by the return of school on January 3rd. And I know that was one of the things mentioned in the letter, was that that was part of the decision making. While I'm elated that I can now choose to get my elementary student vaccinated, that doesn't mean that I'm no longer concerned about how the choices we as a district are making will continue to affect every part of our community. The recent update also alluded to COVID-19 now being treated like other infectious diseases that require close monitoring. I haven't found any documented numbers of any of these other diseases that mirror the current numbers of this pandemic since its beginning. While we would all love to snap our fingers and say it's over, desperately we would love to do that. With nearly 50 million cases and counting nationwide and now over 800,000 deaths, we need to accept the reality we have. That being said, I have no doubt the die is cast. I've paid attention to the comments of this board at prior meetings, and while I respectfully disagree with much of what has been said, and equally what has been left unsaid, I now wish not only to have answers to help me understand why decisions have been made, but also to understand what will be done moving forward to get us to work together and solve the hot mess this virus continues to leave us in. I was pleased to see the district offer a vaccination clinic locally, and I thank you for that. Was it successful, and if so, will we do that more often? What are we doing to allow those that may still have concerns or trepidation about getting themselves or their children vaccinated to connect and offer options to answer questions from valid and medical and community professionals to see if perhaps we can combat misinformation and fear with facts and answers from proven medical resources. Vaccines have been proven as our best defense at this point. We need to make sure citizens are hearing true information about what vaccines do and don't do. The CDC website has clear information about their vaccine adverse event reporting system. I think it's pronounced VAERS. And what the actual numbers of adverse effects or possible deaths linked to the vaccine are. I know our board's not choosing to require this vaccine as it does other vaccines, but I'm asking you to do your due diligence and help get real information out to aid people who wish to make an informed decision in hopes that it helps us all get closer to getting out of this pandemic. And so thank you for your time in finishing. I know there's a lot of questions that I asked, so this is what I like to call my calling card. My email address is on the back.
Thank you.
Email me. I'm happy to speak one-on-one if you would like. I try to be calm, cool, and collected in my discussions, even if I disagree. But thank you again. I look forward to hearing from you.
Thank you. Okay. Carol Dixon.
Semester COVID protocols, he brought up a very good point of being careful about when we talk to adults and especially students about masks or vaccines, and that regardless of where you are on either side, somebody that hears you that is in your vicinity can feel left out or feel like they've made the right decision or the wrong decision based on what conversation is happening there. So on that note, I would just like to urge the board and the administration to please reiterate that those conversations are not appropriate to be had between members of the schools and the students in particular, especially as it pertains to vaccination status. That is a personal medical decision that should be between a parent and a child, at most a district nurse, something of that situation, and not something for general discussion, like I know has happened on multiple occasions just for my children in the district. So please keep that in mind, and I urge you to put that in writing.
Thank you. Neil Layshock.
Hi, I'm Neil Lyshock. I have a fourth grader at Moyer Elementary and a sixth grader at the middle school. I'm just going to read a statement here and request a response if you'd like to give it. The last time I stood in front of this school board was September 13th, 2021. According to the CDC, at that time, Campbell County was at the second highest positivity rate at 13.23%. Do you know when the highest positivity rate was in this past year? It was in the 2 weeks following the Christmas break. Campbell County reached a 7-day average percent positivity rate of over 23% after last Christmas, rate doubled from early November to mid-January. On October 29th, the Pfizer vaccine was approved for children ages 5 to 12. The earliest these kids could start receiving their first dose was the following week. I know this because our family searched every available resource for an appointment. Even with a sense of urgency, the earliest appointment our daughter could get was November 8th. So let's assume that every family in the Fort Thomas School District rushed out as quickly as we did to get the kids vaccinated. The earliest any child could have obtained a second dose would be November 29th. The earliest any child could be considered fully vaccinated would Yet on November 30th, you made the decision to announce that face coverings for participants and spectators at events taking place after school hours are encouraged, but not are encouraged but optional. No elementary child in your school district was capable of being fully vaccinated when you sent that announcement. But somehow you thought that it was in their best interest to allow unmasked and potentially unvaccinated adults to pack events like a middle school band concert. I acknowledge that at the time you sent the update regarding the masking policies for this coming year, on November 22nd, the rates seemed to be trending down. But predictably, they have increased since Thanksgiving, and we know that they will spike again after Christmas. Furthermore, the rate of breakthrough infections is also increasing. This is not just in the news. This is happening to families in Fort Thomas. According to the Kentucky Cabinet for Health and Family Services, on their vaccination dashboard, one of the printouts I gave you, specifically in Campbell County, only 20% of children aged 5 to 11 have been vaccinated. Less than half of those are fully vaccinated. In fact, 12 to 15-year-olds have been eligible for 7 months now, and only 44% are fully vaccinated in Campbell County. That means that masks are still the primary defense against illness for more than half the kids in our county. The current guidance for the COVID-19 prevention in K-12 schools from the CDC states, due to the circulating and highly contagious Delta variant, CDC recommends universal indoor masking by all students age 2 and older, staff, teachers, and visitors to K-12 schools regardless of vaccination status. In addition to the universal indoor masking, CDC recommends schools maintain at least 3 feet of physical distancing between students within classrooms to reduce the transmission risk. When it is not possible to maintain physical distance of at least 3 feet, such as when schools cannot fully reopen while maintaining these distances, it is especially important to layer multiple other prevention strategies, such as screening and testing. I know that you are aware of these guidelines. I also know that you are tracking the local rates of infection like the rest of us. None of this should be a surprise to you. I'd like to ask this board, does your masking guideline make our kids safer? If you cannot definitively say yes, then I would ask that you please explain your rationale for your decision. What scientific studies or public health guidance are you relying on to make the decision that it is safer to allow masks to be optional than to require them? To be very clear, I do not believe the lack of state or local law requiring masks in schools justifies this board's decision not to require masks. That is like saying that students, teachers, and parents don't have to wear appropriate clothing in school simply because there is no law requiring them to do so. This school has implemented a dress code despite no state mandate requiring them to do so. There should also be a mask requirement regardless of any legal mandate. It goes without saying that our state and federal politicians are considering their political careers when choosing which laws to draft, support, and enact. This school board has the sole and direct responsibility of creating a safe and healthy learning environment for all students, without regard to politics. There is no dispute that masking is necessary to create a safe and healthy learning environment when COVID transmission rates are high and the season for increased transmission is imminent. So I ask you, what is the basis for your decision to not require our students to take the safest approach for the sake of our children by requiring all people to wear masks? And I'll ask that you respond to one follow-up question as well. How do you respond to the belief of many in the community that you are putting politics ahead of our children? I'm interested to hear your response.
Thank you.
And again, I'll say that we're gonna discuss some of the changes in the protocol when we have our presentation in just a little bit. As I said from the start, we've been balancing maximizing the number of students who are in our schools with providing as close to a normalized experience as humanly possible. The part that I did not talk about was we are going to utilize a lot of local data and local trends as we make some of the decisions that we have within the district. We are at a point where the overwhelming majority of our families have access to vaccination, to whichever degree that they choose to take advantage of that. By the time we return on the 3rd of January, families can engage in that. And we also believe that we have to partner with our families to take steps and provisions to make sure that we reduce the spread internally. That's what motivated the decision. I do think there'll be some discourse around it. There'll be people that disagree with it on both sides, but that was the driver of the decisions that we made.
So if the transmission rate keeps going up, is this decision locked in stone? You will not change your mind? It's, masks off no matter what, and even if that puts kids at risk?
I think we have differing, and again, I don't want to get into a debate here at community forum. You asked a question, and so that's where I'd like to let it stand. I think probably the best, if there's additional conversation to have, would be to contact my office, to contact Jamie Flaherty, and to discuss it from then. But I think we've debated a lot of that discussion, and this just probably isn't the right forum for that back and forth.
Thank you. Eric Tace.
You
nailed it. Oh, good.
Eric Tace, I have two kids in the system. Clearly, we're putting normalcy over science or data or et cetera, et cetera. So I'm willing to put my two kids up for losing the normalcy of having no mask in favor of having a mask. So at least you can mark them down as they're in on the side of statistics, as you pointed out. Seems we're ignoring, and science, which it also seems we're ignoring, in an education system. So.
Thank you.
Well, no, thank you.
Greta Herberth?
Very good.
Oh, good. I'm trying.
Mr. Robinson and school board members, my name is Greta Herberth, and my daughter Caroline is a sixth grader in the middle school. I am from Cincinnati, and I like to say my husband dragged me over across the river, and my mother was like, "Why are you moving to Kentucky?" And I knew very little about Northern Kentucky when you grew up in Cincinnati. It was back in my day, maybe back in some of your days, since we never really kind of connected or crossed the river. And I've been here for 13 years now, 12 years now, and I love this community, and I'm really proud to be a member of this community. My daughter was here. We're very proud of her. She was a leader today. Mm-hmm. She's not always a leader. She's a great kid. But she's been on the flip side of getting in a few scrapes or being the victim of bullying in the school district, and I think that's just part of being a kid and growing up. And I've always felt that I've had the respect of, I tell black laborers here, and the respect of the people that I've had to deal with throughout the years. There's a lot of times in the past year and a half that I felt like I'm the only moderate left on earth. And what I wanted to share with you is that I appreciate everything that you guys do. I believe and I hope that you continue to keep an open mind about what is best for our kids as things change, not only with this virus, but also with things that come up that are different and maybe things that we didn't have to address back in my day or your day. I don't necessarily know what the right answers are. I read, try to be smart about things, and I ask that all of you continue to look out for what is best for our children, not engage in political dialogue on the left or right,
Thank you.
And I'm going to take my kid because she hasn't eaten, so.
Yeah. Toby Varlin.
Hi, my name is Toby Varlin. You guys may be getting tired of seeing me in these things. I'm going to try to respect what you asked at the beginning of this community forum and not talk about individuals, but I am going to go there on that subject a little bit. I was here at this meeting last month and was very dismayed to hear the intentional, repeated, unaddressed misgendering of a student at Highlands High School. I don't know the student. I don't know the community members who did this. There were two. But what I will say is it is, I was frustrated with myself for not addressing it in the moment, because any kid who is transgender or LGBTQ anywhere in that vicinity deserves more than to have adults standing in a room talking about their genitals. Honestly, I was so taken aback that, you know, it was something that I find to be perverse. I, you know, in looking at this after the meeting, the UCLA Law Review has actually outlined a framework for sanctioning attorneys who do that. Even in cases where using a person's preferred pronouns may hurt their case, attorneys are in line for sanctions for intentionally misgendering a person the way that community members did here last month. The Canadian High Court, as I understand their equivalent of our Supreme Court, has called intentionally misgendering another person a human rights violation. You know, in my mind, the issue that was brought up last month was that a student was uncomfortable sharing a restroom with somebody who was transgender. You know, a few short decades ago, that person might have been in here talking about how a student was uncomfortable sharing a restroom with an N-word. And if somebody came in here to this meeting and used that word in that context repeatedly, I'd like to think someone would have stopped them and said, hey, there's no place for that here. We need to do the same thing with the issue that came up last month. You know, I apologize to the students for not being a better ally and for not standing up for them. I hope others will reach out again. I don't know who this student is. I assume some of you probably do. And I would like to think that somebody in a position of power will stand up and reach out to this student and say, you deserve better than us sitting there silently thus listening to this. In the months since that board meeting, I try to come to these things, I try to not make it overtly political. In the months since that board meeting, the local, very conservative political action committee has sent out an email touting their accomplishments at last month's board meeting and talking about how they were proud of what they came and said. And they expected the other side to be out tonight in numbers because of how successful they were at last month's board meeting. And I think it's a sad day when, as a parent who comes to these board meetings to advocate not only for my kids, but for every kid in this district, I'm labeled as the other side. I don't know what side this group is on. I'm on the side of the kids in this district. You know, I don't see people who differ in opinion from me as the other side. I see them as diverse perspectives, and we should all be working together to try to make this a better district. You know, Mr. Robinson, you said earlier tonight that Fort Thomas, we always want this to be a destination district where families want to move here, teachers want to come teach here. And if we let groups like this political action committee send this district back to the Stone Age by banning books that are inconvenient, by throwing out social equity classes because it's a hard thing to hear, by denigrating students in this district, it's going to become a destination district in all the ways that I don't think we want it to become a destination district. So, again, I urge everybody here to please be more aware of the kind of language that, you know, I don't know who said it, but there's a famous quote out there that says, you know, what you accept, you condone. And we all sat here last month and accepted this speaking this way about a student in our district, and I had to come here tonight to say I don't condone it, and I hope that others will echo that sentiment as well. Thank you.
Thank you. I will say for me that I want to honor all children. You know, every parent that comes here looks through the lens of their child, and I feel that I want to do that too, and I do that too. So I appreciate your saying that, and I will do a better job of protecting children. And we all know that you all were young once. Everybody's on a journey. You know, what's that going to end up being? So I want us to be respectful, and so thank you very much. That's it.
I didn't say that I should have. Mm-hmm. I understand that the man who came and spoke, I'm not trying to minimize the feelings of his daughter. I understand I have a daughter who's a freshman in high school. If she's uncomfortable with something, I want to address that. Mm-hmm. I don't mind her being uncomfortable. I may think she shouldn't be, but that doesn't mean she's not. Mm-hmm. I may think that he shouldn't be, but it doesn't mean he's not. However, as you guys pointed out last month, a solution's been offered to the problem that was brought up. All students have access to private restrooms where they never have to share a restroom with somebody they're uncomfortable with. Maybe it's less convenient, but I'm not in any way trying to minimize that parent's discomfort, that other student's discomfort, but I think it's important to say that there was already a solution to this issue before he came and spoke in a dehumanizing and, I believe, hateful way. So.
Thank you. Okay, Kelly Pratt Booth.
Newly.
I know. Newly. You're going to talk about yourself, too?
Certified.
You're going to talk about. I know.
I wasn't planning on talking about that. But yeah.
I know. That's awesome.
I'm excited. It's been a good past couple
You're
days.
Excited to be finished.
I'm uh-huh. very excited to be finished. Uh-huh. It was one heck of a roller coaster.
Well, congratulations.
There were some tears. Mm-hmm. Not going to lie. But I'm actually here to recognize some other people that are absolutely fantastic. Some of our Fort Thomas Education Association members. We've got one from Johnson, one from the middle school, and one from the high school. So we'll start with Johnson. At the elementary level, they've decided to recognize the work of Marie Zimmerman. Recently, she and her specials team organized and led the Family Culture Night and Book Fair. She was instrumental in ensuring that Johnson Elementary students explored cultures from around the world. Her focus on research was evident in the student work, and she helps our students embody the portrait of a graduate competencies of curious and critical thinking and global communication. Marie also runs the Journalism Club that allows elementary students an opportunity to explore written and broadcast journalism and opening them up to possible career paths. Which is fantastic at such a young age. It's just wonderful. She is also the fix-it lady at Johnson, always going above and beyond to ensure that we can properly use our technology for its intended purpose. And Johnson Elementary is so grateful to have her with us in this district, and the association is grateful for her as well. For anyone that did not get to go to the culture night, it was absolutely amazing. I teach world history, and seeing the level of research that our fourth graders were doing was absolutely amazing. It was done with such care and creativity. It was just phenomenal to watch, and Ms. Zimmerman's work was instrumental in making that happen for our kids. We'll move to the middle school next. We have another fantastic teacher who is also an association member that is taking gigantic steps to provide these student-led opportunities for kids at the middle school. The middle school has chosen to recognize Mrs. Lisa Berkeley. And this fantastic woman has organized so many different programs and events that have fostered student leadership. She works tirelessly with the middle school journalism students to provide them with a very wide array of real world, mm-hmm. R's and W's together are tough, real world experiences, which is gonna prepare them for success when they leave the nest. And as a high school teacher, I deeply appreciate that. I can see that work when those students come into my classroom as sophomores. In addition, Mrs. Berkeley has helped these students organize 9/11 presentations, a field trip to the zoo, yearbook sales, and helped them partner with Moyer to spread some holiday cheer. This work has pushed our middle school students to become leaders. In addition to her work with the journalism students, Mrs. Berkeley organized a pumpkin carving contest and replaced all the pictures on the big walls at the middle school. So she is continuing the work that our middle school student council is doing, which is wonderful. And these efforts are really important. I know it's kind of like, oh, art and pictures, but these efforts really do go a long way in creating an environment that is welcoming to our students and makes them feel that pride and encourages them to learn at the highest levels. She has done all of this for the students at the middle school on top of managing planning and grading, all of that for four separate courses. That is a monumental lift right there. All right, last but not least, we're gonna recognize one of our classified members at the high school. As all of you should know, our custodians are working tirelessly, practically around the clock. And it's not just to, like, you know, handle COVID. That is a big element, but they have not dropped that responsibility for making things happen for our students. So, like, they have not dropped the ball in any capacity in making sure our facilities are top-notch and ready to go for all of the amazing activities that we recognize in our showcases, that our teachers are able to implement. The custodians really are the backbone of a lot of what teachers and students are able to do in our buildings. So in light of that, the high school has selected Mr. Jason Moore. Mr. Moore serves as one of our hardworking custodians. Most mornings, you can see Mr. Moore in the crosswalk, helping students get to school safely. He is also there to assist teachers. Whenever an event is planned, Jason is there helping move furniture to get set up so that our teachers and students can be successful and helping get that cleaned up so that it's ready for the next group that comes in. Recently, Mr. Moore went above and beyond to serve some of our extracurricular groups at this year's holiday walk. Mr. Moore helped each of these student groups set up their tables, get things moved. The event started off as a beautiful day, not a single cloud in the sky. Unfortunately, that did not hold. For the last hour, we had some pretty torrential rain, and Mr. Moore quickly jumped into action when the rain arrived and assisted all of our clubs that were set up at the high school in getting their tables moved undercover, helped set up a canopy so that our students could finish providing that community leadership that we were pushing all of them to do. He was also there to help these groups break things down and clean up, and because of his efforts, these extracurricular groups had a successful event. And I walked by after everything was done, and you could not tell that anything had happened there. There was not a speck of trash, anything, anywhere in the vicinity. And I was like, there was a lot of kids here, and there was a lot of trash. I don't know how, it was like magic. And he was the only custodian that was there, and I was just amazed by that. So, thank you.
Thank you. And I love how the custodians are part of our team. So they come towards us. It's not like you have to find them.
Right.
You know, when there's an event up there, they're like, what are we doing? You know, we're part of the team.
They come and find you. Like, I didn't have to ask. Like, one of my groups was out there, and I didn't have to ask for a single thing. Mm-hmm. He was just there and made sure that I had it before I even knew I needed it, which was awesome.
And just to reiterate what some of us alluded to, congratulations again, Kelly, for achieving National Board Certification. Quite an accomplishment.
Congratulations. Okay, at this time.
I apologize that I didn't sign up beforehand. I'm only asking for three sentences. I ask that you address for our children the diseases of anxiety, depression, social withdrawal, and delayed learning. Treatment for these illnesses take months, years, if ever they are resolved. COVID is surely a disease. It's an illness. There are many successful and very quick treatments. I ask that you look at these other diseases as well, and I appreciate any consideration. I apologize for not signing up. I really
wasn't there. Okay, we are closing the opening of the meeting, and we are going into the action items. This ends the community forum, so anybody that wants to leave may leave or stay. That's good, too. We're going to discuss a lot of different things, but the first one up on the action items is Jerry Wisman. I know, I kept looking through. I know.
We just wanted to give a quick update, let you know some of the things we have been working on. We have pretty much all of that outstanding work that's scheduled for over on a break. Schmidt Plumbing will be coming in on Kelly's design to add the additional 6-inch roof drain. putting water in place. We didn't like it, so that work will begin on the 20th. We're also going to have Queen City Mechanical in there, and they're going to smoke test the plumbing system in order to ensure that everything is good, and that there's nothing on the interior that's causing that sewer gas smell. And then once we have ascertained that that is indeed the case, then we will take what action is necessary to prevent it from being pulled in by the HVAC system and distributed to certain areas of the building. So those are the two major outstanding things related to RL construction. And then one that we're doing on our own, we're installing a sidewalk that runs from that main level exit down below up around to the parking lot. There's a lot of individuals who have been parking in the parking lot and then making their way down the grass to that door to enter and exit the building. It's also emergency egress for fire drills. So as they say with colleges and universities, a lot of times they build a building and then wait on the sidewalks until they see where the kids walk, and where they've killed the grass, they put the sidewalk in. We've done something similar with this.
Good idea.
So we're waiting until January for Morrell, what we believe will be Morrell's final payout, and then we may even start the final documents for KE at that time in the form of a BG4 for you.
I want to say publicly that the sewer gas issue is a very high priority, and we will get to the bottom of it no matter what. You don't build a $27 million school and have sewer gas odor in there. And it's just unacceptable. I don't know what's going on. I don't know why it's taking so long. I'll reserve to the smoke test and see what happens from there. But nobody's getting final payout until that's fixed.
That's our hope. So hopefully we can bring that to you in January because everything is resolved.
That's where we need to be. Thanks, Jerry.
Thanks, Jerry. Anybody else? Any other questions come?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right.
Thanks, Jerry. Okay, the next is Summer Rosa. Questions or anything?
Mm-hmm.
All right. I need a motion for the approval of the request for waiver for shortened school day.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Against? Okay. Passes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Jamie Flaherty.
Hi. Good evening.
Good evening.
Today, actually, I'm going to start on 88 contracts, not our healthy school. I believe it's okay. But that's okay. Jump. As past practices, each year we do want to review our ADA contracts and partnerships with our districts in Northern Kentucky. And so I present to you a list, and also want to include Barron County. Barron County is our partner district that has Babel, and Babel is an online program that at times some of our students participate in while not at Fort Thomas schools. So as a consideration there, again, this is an opportunity for us to receive SEEK payments and have a partnership with these districts as we're looking at tuition payments and the reduction of their cost as a tuition family for next school year. And so I'm foreshadowing that I will be coming to you with tuition and considerations of that for the following month in January. But today we're going to consider ADA contracts. Understanding that House Bill 563 has been implemented in some capacity, and we know that we will hear more. We want to be mindful of our practices and be prepared for next school year, so we are asking you to approve these for 2022-23.
Just very briefly, there will be a requirement in going into next spring that we do a revision for our non-resident policies. That is the main gist of House Bill 563. Guidance around what those policy changes are not available yet. We've been working with Kentucky School Board Association. They're going to wait for the legislative action this spring before they make any recommendations for changes in policy. So we're, as Jamie said, this is a proactive step to make sure we maintain our agreements, knowing that there could be some adjustments as well.
Okay. All right, I need a motion for the approval of ADA contracts for the 22-23 school year.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Thank you.
Our next agenda item is a school-wide fundraiser. You can recognize that in July each year, I present to you a list by school for the entire season. As we see, there have been some changes. We do have two schools, both Moyer and Johnson, are looking to add our TOMI, which is a school-wide fundraiser at their events, their school-wide events. So it's an opportunity for the purchase of art, student artwork. And then the school does receive a portion of those proceeds as a fundraiser. So those were excluded and added most recently.
Okay, thank you.
I need approval for the...
Do you need approval?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. I need a motion for a new school-wide fundraiser added at Johnson and Moyer Elementary for the 21-22 school year.
So moved.
Second?
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay.
We are moving forward to discussion items. So
yes.
I will let Peggy have a moment to breathe and transition to a PowerPoint.
Very good.
Considering our healthy at school, looking at our updates for January 3rd, as Mr. Robinson had shared earlier, there was communication in November related to our protocol as we consider COVID and keeping an in-person experience for our students a priority while also maintaining the personal experience and maximizing the collaborative efforts while here at school. And so when you're looking at the four considerations that we have up there currently, we're going to be looking at what we're changing. And so I'm going to focus on masking while recognizing the other three, social distancing, temperature screening, and sanitizing are remaining the same. It's been referenced earlier this evening, the approach of layering. And so with that, we are being very mindful of that approach moving forward. So starting in January, most have wanted the opportunity to have an added layer, and we encourage our students and parents, if that would be a type of mask that they would want to wear, that is an option for our students as well.
Jamie, you got a quick question?
Sure.
The bus transportation, where is that one coming from? Is that from federal?
Is
that from the state?
Yes, yeah, so and most recently, if you look that up, on November the 30th, there was an extension to that federal order that does require us, while being transported, and our buses are included in that order, that they have to remain masked.
Okay.
Also, we are indicating that our preschool students will be required to wear masks if not 5 years old. So we are sticking to and looking at the option for vaccination, and with those individuals, they are not able at a age to receive the vaccine.
Thank you.
I do have just a couple of additional slides to clarify. So wanting to make sure that we understand what's going to happen with a symptomatic case. And so if you have a symptom, it could be a headache, it could be a runny nose, it could be a cough, students now are sent home. Students now are required to either have a negative COVID test or an alternate diagnosis from a medical provider. That's not going to change. That still is going to be a requirement. If we have students that are, or a teacher that would be showing symptoms, we are going to be still requiring either a negative PCR test or an alternate diagnosis to be participating in extracurriculars and at school during the school day. We also will be using Gravity to have our full PCRs administered throughout the day. We are moving the timing of that up to earlier, more so in the morning than late afternoon, so that we can ensure that our test results come back prior to the following school day. Most recently, we are recognizing a delay. Now, Gravity did have an issue this past week with software, and that was system-wide. Even if you went through the drive-thru, there was a delay with the tests that were being processed there. But we recognized after collaborating with them this past week, if we move the time up for delivery prior to midday, then we will have our test results back sooner, so that we will have students and teachers back in the following school day if they are negative. We are going to have tests to stay as an opportunity for our staff. When we're looking at our rapid PCR, they're not the 15-minute rapid test, they're the 30. So it's considered very similar to a full PCR test. We are going to be screening our teachers with that. However, we are not going to be offering that for our students. As we recognize, and you'll see, and I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself, but with contact tracing, we are not going to be facilitating that in the same way. So I am not identifying, let's say, a number of 5 students that could be in close contact to a positive exposure. It would be that an email will be going out to those families to indicate that positive exposure was in that classroom, and we're asking parents to monitor for symptoms. And so with that, with not the generation of the list, we're not needing the test to stay for students at this time. Things do change and have been for our household cases, so we're going to continue our same practices. If there are multiple members of a household that attend Fort Thomas schools, all students in that household will have to follow the quarantining protocol from the health department and adhere to isolation if you're a positive case. So that if you're positive, again, that's a 10-day isolation. And if you have siblings related to that positive case, their day one will start on the 11th day. So the 10 days of the positive case will be extended. And then the next day will be the first day of that individual's quarantine. So we will still require tests like we are right now. That will not change for our household exposures. Our data, our local data from our school district, as we have compiled our dashboard and that we keep up daily, indicates that most all of our positives that have been related to exposures are coming from household exposures, not school exposures. We've had very few in our district using the test to stay go from a
things. One is this entire approach is really dependent on taking full partnership with our community and our parents. And so making sure that students who have had a direct exposure, who are demonstrating symptoms, supporting the idea that sick kids stay home is critically important for us to be able to have this kind of flexibility. Secondly, we're not approaching this with a blanket approach. We're working with our nurses. We're looking at local and specifically school-centered infection rates. And so we ask that families support principals when they make decisions that are localized to their school around an assembly if they have a high rate of infection or illness, and maybe making a decision to put it in smaller groups or to be more agile in their decision making. And so that's going to be really important that instead of blanketing our approaches, that we use what's happening locally. But most, I just implore our families, if kids sick, the best thing we can do right now is keep them at home.
Thank you for a very detailed response or presentation.
Yeah, thank you. I would just say too, I know that you put your note out recently just about what's coming in January, and I think, maybe per some of the questions that came out tonight, is just, and maybe have some flashbacks back to when we were trying to go back to school in 20, and people were like, will they really go back to school? And will they not go back to school? I think, we are, this is our plan. It's not wavering. We're not planning to change that. We've stuck to that since we came out to it. We kind of delayed the process to give people a chance. But I think just making sure people know that when we come back on whatever day that is in January, that this will be in effect. So make plans now. If you want to get the vaccine, you have time. If you want to wear a mask, make plans to do that. So just so families know that this is not, we didn't want to go back and forth the first time, which is why we waited. And so I think we're in a good spot now, and make sure that people know. So I don't know if you're planning to do another update between now and then the school year, but it might be.
Yeah, we'll send a reminder over the break. But to your point, that was the intention. That's why we waited, and it is our intention on January 3rd to return under that plan. But we'll send an additional reminder.
Great, thank you.
Any others? Okay, the next discussion item.
So switching gears, uh-huh. We're making the resiliency poll. And if you recall, our resiliency poll is our annual commitment to our students to measure their social emotional health. This is a screener that's given to students in grades 3 through 12. There is a permission aspect to this, so you can opt out as a parent to have your student participate. And I'd like to share our results for this year. As I manipulated the numbers and I reflected back on previous school years, you're going to see similar data and similar trends. For this fall, we screened 2,264 students in grades 3 through 12. Last year, we were off by 200. We screened a little over 2,000. So this year, we had the capability with everyone on campus to be able to reach more students. And again, we're looking at our positive school learning experiences and how that impacts an individual student's capacity to relate to the social stressors that they deal with on a day-to-day basis and how we can overcome those as adults to make their experience better. And so when looking at this, you're going to see data trends. We go back as far as spring 2018. And so very quickly, in a snapshot, if you're looking at our results, this data is opposite. Dr. Gilman has a way of thinking that's different than mine. So we're looking at your left. If you're looking at the stream, that's the most recent. And so the furthest left is fall 2021. The furthest right is spring 2018. And so with that, this current school year, we had 63% of our students in the green, if you combine the 44 and the 19. So our optimal and our satisfactory. The previous year, we had 64. And the year before that, we had 65. So you can see, statistically, we were very similar. If you look at our at-risk percentages for the district, current year, we have 9%. Previous COVID year, we had 7. The year prior to that was 7. And then that spring year we had was 12.
And Jamie, with the at-risk, those students, to the point made earlier in the community forum, those students are are spoken with and given assistance.
Correct.
And okay. Correct.
So there would be a priority response. Our counselors have been trained, and they will take the opportunity. The system itself ranks the students by priority. So when we receive the reports back, which would be instantaneous, they will then start at the very top and work their way down to figure out who would be at risk. And we contact them that day, the parent that day, after consulting with the students. And then you'll see eventually there will be a plan designed for the students based on that interaction and the needs there. So in order for me to show you an overview at the district level, I've got just a couple of key highlights. Probably not surprising, as it's very similar to last year. You can see that our percent of youth placed at risk remains steady and 3% below our first and second years when we were considering those. Also, we recognize we have 63% overall that would be green. However, we're not dismissing our most at need. When you're looking at across the school levels, our mean scores for all of the variables, they either remain the same statistically, and I'll show you what that means in a second, or they increased from the last year. And then the fourth bullet indicates that our depression scores increased 1% at the middle and high school, and anxiety stayed the same. But last year, it was the opposite. Anxiety increased just slightly, and depression stayed the same. So we know there are issues with our students that are feeling anxious and depressed, and we are seeing and identifying who those students are. And then I know that something that spoke out to us last year was that comment about ostracism and having students feel as if they were included. And so we do have an increase this year at the middle school for 4% of those additional students that feel as if they are ostracized or they are not included. So looking at extracurricular opportunities, our teams, and how they function, other opportunities, what can we do to reduce those? And those students are labeled, and those counselors know and identify who those students are.
Maybe we can utilize our student leaders.
Absolutely. Find something engaging for them to want to explore. Mm-hmm. Yes. Currently now, I'm going to review quickly elementary, middle, and high school scores. And so I include all of the historical data here so that you can reference this. It's on our website when we're looking at our board report so that you can review. The furthest to the right, I want you to remember that the ranges change. They're not always out of 6 points. So when we're looking at the scale, you need to make sure that you're referencing the range. As well, most all of the ranges with a higher number are typically a positive growth. However, ostracism is not. You would want a smaller number. So when we're looking at ostracism, I do have an asterisk here to indicate that that should be a number that would be quite low rather than high. And so if looking at trend data with all three elementary schools together, you are going to see that there has been growth with global satisfaction, positive school experiences, hope, and ostracism compared to last year. You also can see the fall historical time, so I want you to know that the yellow indicates that this number that is in yellow would indicate a negative when you're looking at trends. However, they're not statistically significant when you're looking at tenths of points. But we know that we need to make sure that we're being mindful of our domains and those variables there. So an example would be grit. Halfway down, last year we were at 3.52 on a 5-point scale. We decreased to 3.43. That is not statistically significant. So Dr. Gilman says that's the same. So when we're looking at those, however, we can recognize that there were more responses that indicated a lower number, so that we need to look at our practices and make sure that we're doing what we need for our students. So the trend data you can see for ostracism, this is the one that will reflect the 4% of students that feel additional ostracism compared to previous years, which would have been 2.07. But then relative, looking at our regional in 2019, it would be 2.41 as a region. So that very bottom line there, when you're looking at comparison from district to district at middle school range. And then for high school, our high school had similar responses in the sense the numbers were very close. Again, grit last year at the high school, 3.58. This year, 3.52. We will continue to address. You're going to see most all of those numbers are going to fall to the same or very similar, with the indication that we need to make sure that we are addressing all of our students and their needs. And then we have two more slides with some additional graphs. This would be solely with pulling out the data for anxiety and depression. So if you look at your left, you're going to see those are middle school scores. The one on the right would be high school scores. And it's opposite. Again, I did not create this, so it's against what I, my better judgment, my mind. So the far left of the left side of middle school is current. That's going to be now. Mm-hmm. And so we are seeing that there is an uptick in the anxiety, which we had indicated. And then the depression scores stay similar to where they were. And then for high school, you can see actually that both anxiety and depression are falling around the 6% of the students. And you see a decline in one and a uptick small in others. I do want to make a note that on the left side, not to minimize this, but the scale is single digit. So making sure that you're recognizing that that scale goes up to 10%, it does show that we can validate our students. Without this screener, I'm sure that our counselors, our teachers can recognize most all of these students. However, there are some students that we don't recognize. And so having conversations with our families, our counselors, all of our teachers to facilitate what works for those students to reduce stress, to reduce anxiety, is all worth what the data that we're receiving today. And then there's one final set of screeners. There would be the four that we completed three of. We did not complete the drug alcohol screener, which is the red, because we typically as a district participate in the KIPP survey. That's a statewide survey. Last year we did not have the KIPP survey, so we did it for 1 year only. So you're not going to see the red that would be on there. And then you're going to see middle school on the left, high school on the right, the most recent on the left. And so when you're looking at ostracism, which is the darker green, you're going to see higher from the previous year in the middle school, higher also for traumatic stress. And then an interesting one that we've added 2 years ago that is fairly new is self-criticism. So those kids that complete a task, they're reflective and they're really hard on themselves. They really beat themselves up and they can't move forward past their experiences. These students, we've indicated that we have 3% of our middle schoolers that feel that way on a daily basis. And then looking at the high school, our high school had a decrease in ostracism, a decrease in traumatic stress, and also a decrease in self-criticism report from the previous school year. And then finally, I want you to see just a snapshot of what a student report looks like. This would be what our counselors
guess since, especially the last year and a half that students have dealt with, that it's good that we're not seeing the numbers jump. So hopefully mm-hmm. our efforts to provide a somewhat normal school year has helped in that. So hopefully we'll see those numbers go down though after this year.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Thank you, Jamie. Okay, and then Bill, are you going to do strategic plan?
Yes. So I just have an update this evening on the development of our five-year strategic plan. So if this is better served with dialogue, I'm happy for this discussion item to be held in that capacity. As you know, we are striving towards a decade of excellence. That was something that we originally conceptualized together when we met for the first time under Superintendent Robinson's leadership. And so in order to make tenure growth, we really need itinerant opportunities to progress monitor and to have some short-term goals. So we have idealized a five-year strategic plan of which you've been engaged in from the onset. And so the districts, you know, one of the first things I had the privilege of sharing tonight was our the commendations for continuous improvement. That has been a culture that Fort Thompson Independent Schools has encompassed for the last over two decades. Thinking back towards the early part of 2000, with Vision 2020, the next follow-up to that came in the early 2010s, 2019, with the development of a revised mission. And then about 5 years ago, we were able to conceptualize a culture of our graduates. Each one of those really incorporated different components of how our district was going to continue to learn and continue to grow so that student achievement ultimately and the experiences that we offered our students under our tutelage would continue to be exceptional as compared to other locations. And so where we're at now is really in the next step in this continuous improvement process with a lot of data, qualitative and quantitative, that we're using in order to make decisions. And so all of that has been included in consideration of our strategic plan. You see on the screen artifacts that hopefully you yourselves will recall, but we have really been through 6 months of a development process to make sure that whatever strategic plan we are able to put into a final format for you next semester has been well thought out, has been well researched, and has evidence behind it, so that the things that we are committing to are certainly items that have credence and value on behalf of our students. So you see reflections of our initial brainstormings through some of the collaborative efforts that we put into place to get stakeholder input, at least at the leadership level. I'll be speaking to stakeholder input at other levels here momentarily. But really, this is what started it all. And when we think about today's date, December the 13th of 2021, we are at a place where we have committed to where we are going to go with our strategic plan. We have decided upon five areas. These may be benefits for our students, but definitely five umbrellas by which we are going to commit our efforts towards strategic improvement. A positive and engaged culture is one of those. Achievement is another. Student experiences and opportunities, another. Individual student growth, number four, not in rank order. And then portrait of graduate. What does that look like as a Fort Thomas graduate for us? So leadership across the district and schools have collaborated with your support and assistance to be able to develop what is our objective for each one of these areas. So if we sort of isolate one of them, we really talk about individual student growth. That's fairly imperative. What we are looking for in that domain is to promote continuous growth and individual success, so the secular level, for a student based upon something that we have articulated, something that has been collaboratively developed across professionals, and something that will truly address what their needs are, what their abilities are, and where their interests lie. And so, as a team, we have taken each one of these areas, each one of these benefits, come up with an objective. This is what we will accomplish in 5 years. So once we're at a place where we can present the final draft of our strategic plan, then we can hold us accountable in 5 years for meeting the objective. You can certainly hold us accountable for the metric associated with those objectives. So what we've spent the most time doing, and what I want you to understand, I'm going to come back to that side, is we have draft components of how we aim to achieve these objectives. What we've done is we've thought to ourselves, what are the things that we can put into place, strategies, that will actually help us to realize these goals? And then a
activities that we can monitor and be mindful of that will help us to achieve the desired results or, you know, the preferable outcomes. This is small on purpose because we are not intending to share publicly right now the components of our draft strategic plan. They're very much still in draft format, and we're continuously receiving some input in order to make sure that we can provide to you an outline that's a little bit more affirmative and a little bit more consistent with where we're headed in 5 years. I will bring to your attention, I will remind you, as well as to all of our friends that are engaged in this meeting tonight, that we first had a collaborative experience in November last month with our council-to-council meeting. We met here, you spent your time with each of our school-based decision-making councils to really talk through what is the initial language of our strategic plan looking like. And we asked for feedback related to alignment, what does it look like with regards to, are we missing components? And then do you have any suggestions for revisions to some of these pieces? And thus far, we've received a lot of really good qualitative feedback as it relates to semantics, like language. So for example, when we use terms such as stakeholders, or when we talk about metric components, such as having dashboards, what do those things look like to anyone who lives in Fort Thomas? So there could be a level of assurance and a level of security that all of our investments, time, resources, financial, are all going towards what we are all committed to, which are essential components of continuous improvement by all means. And so where we are going next is thinking in terms of how do we get additional perspectives on the work that we are doing. So student groups, teacher groups, and parent guardian groups are going to be asked to provide very specific additional feedback and input into the development of our plan so that we can further evaluate what we've put in writing so far and consider any modifications that would meet the needs of all of our stakeholders. Along with parents and guardians, we do have a significant community group, whether those are residents or whether those are business partners, that we want to also engage in the process. And so we really want to loop those together and kind of merge those two perspectives. We started with a stakeholder group today, our introduction to education students, put their eyes on our draft strategic plan and had some great both commendations as well as feedback for what we can consider moving forward. And then as we progress into the new year, when we return from this winter break, we will further engage with our stakeholder groups to get some additional feedback. That's more immediate, that's very soon. More long range is we are really considering, once we have our strategic plan ready to unveil and act upon, we want to make sure that we're carrying it through with a level of integrity and also fidelity. So we do, we have thought through some leadership and implementation teams that would be representative of multiple stakeholders within our district, in fact all, that can really help to drive forward the progress, hold us accountable along the way, provide us with support along the way, and also evaluate if our resources are truly being aligned to the desired outcomes that we're seeking. And so we will further be articulating those teams and deciding upon what that composition should look like and how they should act, behave, and carry forward their work. And then we have a whole vision for how to utilize an outward-facing dashboard to be able to share with all of our stakeholder groups how we are doing as they relate to our goals. So we want to really provide some metrics and some progress updates for each of the items that live under each of these areas. We want to provide a level of security, a level of assurance that we are making progress towards these objectives. And so we have an entire vision for putting together a dashboard that will articulate that success and really share where we are as it relates to the goals that we have in place. And so we understand that this will be a district-wide plan, and we're really excited about it and committed to the implementation. And we're really looking forward to some personalization at the school level so that some of these pieces will require developmental appropriateness based upon the learner's age and capacities. And so there will be some opportunities there for independent implementation. But for the most part, we are really excited to have a unified vision and a unified approach across the school district to make concerted efforts, continuous improvement in the areas that we have deemed the most appropriate for us to take next steps. And so this simply was a status update to let you know that we are on par with being able to share with you in the early part of 2022 what our commitment is to this strategic plan.
make progress, continue to earn accolades, and continue to open up the door for our students to be most successful in moving forward.
Questions? The other thing that I want to talk about is, yes, we're planning, and yes, we're putting these things in place, but we're working on achievement. We're working, you know, these things are ongoing right now. Student experiences, individual student growth. I mean, it's you know, we're not putting these things out on a plan waiting to happen, that it's day to day. It's just defining what that plan will be going forward, so.
Yes, I think one of the benefits of making sure that this was a collaborative experience amongst our district leadership and school leadership is that our schools have really taken the lead in moving forward with implementation of multiple goals associated with each one of these areas so that there is no significant, so there is no delay, so there is no wait time to be able to see some progress. Also, our school leaders are exceptional in the fact that they're very strategic minded in and of themselves. We have very well documented, very specified comprehensive school and district improvement plans. And so our school principals have been really spectacular in merging the concepts that they know have been embedded within the initial draft of the strategic plan within their school improvement plans at the same time. I had the pleasure of watching one presentation earlier today at 4 p.m. at Highlands High School, in which the comprehensive school improvement plan that that SBDN council approved is very much aligned with the areas that also are identified in our strategic plan. So.
And I love that process in doing that meeting because, you know, I'm high school centric because that's my, you know, my experience, but I sat with Moyer and their group. So it was talking, you know, what does that look like for a second grader? I know pretty much what it looks like for a 9th, 10th, or 11th grader, but what does that look like for a second grader knowing what they have to be when they're at, as a 9th grader, or where they have to be achievement-wise and that sort of thing. So I do like the across-school dialogue we're having.
Mm-hmm. I think what I would leave you with is that we want to be better. And so we recognize that we're already fairly spectacular, but we have so many areas to be even better, and that's what we're striving to do and be. And so as we want our students to know, do, and be excellent, we want to also mirror that, and we're real committed to it. And this is definitely our pledge to be able to do that.
Yeah.
This is the work that fires me up the most, frankly, just to put it as plainly as I can. To start the year, and from the onset, we talked in a very intentional way to reflect and renew. We needed to take some intentionality and build a positive and engaged environment so that we're not talking about COVID all the time, we're not talking about masking all the time, we're not talking about divisive topics in continuity. We needed to remember who we are, we need to remember what we're about, we remember where we're coming from, and give our teachers, who are fantastic, the best that are out there, an opportunity to make the ground stop moving, to focus on our why, to focus on, in an intentional way on where we need to be. But we realized from the start that our purpose of existing is twofold. One is we're gonna be the heartbeat of our community. Our school is gonna reflect the community expectations and values and the things that have existed since we cracked our doors open in the 1800s. And the second part is that we're gonna focus in an intentional way for personalized student success at the individual level. So how do we make sure that each individual student that comes through our doors and goes through a K-12 experience, a pre-K-12 experience, do they get the benefit of the excellence from the past while we're looking at that continuous focus on the future? And so there's intentionality in these areas in that we're focused on achievement, we're focused on experiences and the experiences our kids have and that individual student growth. So I'm excited about it. I'm excited about the work that Bill's helped lead in a strategic way across the buildings, the collaborative nature of what we have in front of us, and the feedback we're going to get from our community. Because the second half of the year, it's time to renew. So thank you, Bill.
Thank you.
Good stuff. Thanks, Bill.
Thank you. Any other questions or anything? Mm-hmm. Okay. The next item on our agenda is board committee updates. So does anybody have an update of one of their committees? Didn't we just do scholarship committee?
Yes. I've been somewhat busy. We did a reading and have are tabulating and making some decisions around teacher scholarships. And then also there was a meeting about sick leave and a decision reached there. So those groups have been
So for those of you who do not know this, but the school board stipends are put into a fund that we do not take our stipends. We fund scholarships for teachers that want to do continuing education. And I was on that committee prior, and you get, I mean, people are working on their time in summer, and it kind of helps defray the cost of what they identify as something they want to work on. So, and I know we give five every year. Five, so anyway, so that meant. And then the breakfast committee continues to give food, so that's an ongoing committee. Breakfast all year. So we did our second one this time, and then we'll do our next one in January. So, any others?
We did meet about facilities, but not a whole lot to report at this point in time.
Yeah, okay. We will have as a corollary to some of the other strategic planning work, we'll have some additional focus on how does our facility and technology plans support that work.
The goals, right? Yeah. Exactly.
And we had a budget meeting. I think that was since the last one. We had a budget meeting to talk about where we are at this point and where we'll be coming at the first of the year, but looks okay.
All right, and then the last thing is the approval of the consent agenda. With all the board members having had the opportunity to review and pursue any questions about all of the items contained, I need a motion for approval of the consent agenda. Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Aye. Okay. Then with that, our meeting is adjourned. Do you have any other questions?
I have a couple.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Wait, I am sorry.
Don't
wait, don't. Don't
put your cat on.
That's right. Stop the press. I'm sorry.
First of all, I want to thank all the community and the school partners for supporting some of the efforts for the schools and communities in Western Kentucky. That tragedy, it's hard to even put in words, and our schools and families have really answered the call. And so, feel free to please look at our website for additional specific physical donations. Some of the requests currently are actually going more toward a monetary support, just from a logistic standpoint. There was a need for physical things early, but they're now probably in additional resources in monetary ways. So thank you all for that. I want to congratulate Jamie Flaherty, who was just recognized as one of our Kentucky Women in Education leaders for the state. We'll probably have a more appropriate celebration next month, but congratulations to Jamie. Well deserved. Our holiday hours over the next couple weeks, the district office will be open Monday through Wednesday from 9 to 3. It's highly likely the buildings will not have a whole lot of public access. They need a break. But just want to let you know the holiday hours there. And then best of luck on exams, and hope everyone has a fantastic break for these next
weeks. Speaking of holiday, you know, I got some great feedback from parents on some of the holiday things going on in the schools, from the choir, the strings, and I know the ones in the elementary school. So thanks for all the teachers and administrators and all the work you do there. I know it's a lot with everything else going on at the end of the year, so we appreciate it.
I think the board now, you're finished, okay, now. And before we adjourn, I just wanted to wish everybody a Merry Christmas and have a wonderful break and holiday. I think a couple of weeks will do us all good for winter break, so enjoy your families. So with that, we can adjourn.